and there is a little wall, I think.
Hello, welcome back to Exotic Wine Travel. I am your host, Matthew Horky. We just got back from a crazy 12-day trip in Slovakia. And why do I say crazy? We spent 12 days getting shuttled from wine region to wine region, producer to producer. In those 12 days, we tasted over 250 wines, which was crazy. We spent the night somewhere new every single night. So basically, we would wake up at 7, 8 a.m., taste all the way sometimes 11 p.m., midnight, and then pack up and do it again over 12 days. It was crazy, but you know what? It was a heck of a lot of fun. One region that we really found ourselves, we really adored, was actually Southern Slovakia, or basically it'd be called Slovensky. Basically, Southern Slovakia, it's the most, you know, it's on the border of Hungary. It's probably the warmest area in Slovakia. If you look at Slovakia, it's on the northern reaches, latitude-wise, of the grape-growing belt. But there are some really nice wines being made there. In South Slovakia, actually, a good majority, sometimes 50, sometimes up to 90% of some of the towns are actually Hungarian. They speak Hungarian. They identify themselves as Hungarian. And so that, especially near the village of Strekov, there's a lot of natural wine, minimal intervention wine. You know, when we found out that we were going to be going to Slovakia, one of the producers that Shireen said that we must visit was Strekov 1075. And it's a really cool producer. He actually is exporting his wines all around the world now. Some of them are pretty darn raw, but some of them are also delicious. And we spent 7 hours with him. It was some of the most memorable experiences of 2017, especially when we were tasting from his sherry-style wines. We were going around saying, look for the poopiest barrel. Which barrel is the poopiest? Which barrel is the poopiest? So we were smelling the stinkiest barrel to find the best oxidative-style wine. There were some very interesting wines. I think from Strekov, 1075, which I found the most exciting, was his Gruner Veltliner called Veltlin. I thought it was incredible. I didn't even think it tastes like a minimal intervention wine. It was just great wine, period. I liked his Aeon, which was his orange wine. Shireen also liked his Alabernay, which was a red wine. Alabernay is a cross between Alicante Boucher and Cabernet Sauvignon. It was made in Ukraine to add color to wines. But actually, it does well in the cooler weather there and can make some big wines. It's funny, when we were tasting it, the owner, winemaker Jolte, said, don't write anything about my Alabernay, because he wasn't so happy with it and proud of it, but I thought it was wonderful wine. After that, we went to one of his friends called Kashnik. Kashnik, actually, to me, was very interesting. They have a huge portfolio. They're working a lot with Riesling Vlaschke, Vels Riesling, Olas Riesling, Grashevina, Grashots, Vlaschke Riesling, whatever you want to call it. Making a lot of different styles, from macerated, slightly macerated, whole berry fermentation, fresh. He also works with some other white grapes, some Riesling, some Chardonnay. He also does some reds. And I was really actually impressed with his wines. Minimal intervention, you could definitely taste, but clean wines, well made, and they have a house style across the entire portfolio. Really like, I will always remember his whites, especially his Gruner Veltliner, has texture. Beautiful texture, feels wonderful. And we were actually impressed with his reds. Beautiful Pinot Noir, Frankovka, Blaufränkisch, and also a Bordeaux blend called Cuvée Maria. I didn't think Cabernet would ripen that far north in Europe, and it was actually a beautiful wine. I was really impressed. The third producer that we visited in that area was called Matišak. And Matišak, very small producer. We had to drive on this dirt road to this really small cellar. They're making minimal intervention wines, but they fine filter everything. So the wines are very easy for people that drink classically styled wines, more conventional type wines, to understand. Focused a lot on whites, but again, they did a good job with the reds, the Frankovka, the Pinot Noir. I thought some vintages were very good. Made an orange wine, also wonderful. And worked with Pinot Blanc, I think Sauvignon Blanc, Chardonnay, Veltz, Riesling, all those kind of grapes. Wines were clean, delicious, well made. I have high hopes for them. They have ECO certification, and their ECO certification, they're producing bio wines, I think they have a bright future ahead of them. The last visit in that triangle was actually a producer we've been wanting to visit for a long time called Bort Friege. Most of his wines are actually available in Hungary because he is ethnically Hungarian. His village is on the border of Hungary and modern day in Slovakia. Sorry. His wines were phenomenal. He focuses a lot on the Hungarian grapes Furman, Haslevelu, Ufark, Kadarka, and then Kékfrankos, Blaufränkisch. All his wines were amazing. The great story is we got to stay at his guest house. And they left, and at night they said, "Okay, we were the only guests there." And then they had the breakfast room with all wines. Like, feel free to have whatever wines that you want. So it was like open bar night, basically. The Haslevelu was great wine. I mean, great wine. They also have a white and a red blend called Supergranum. The wines are just incredibly minerally, beautiful wines. Any way you slice it, great wines, fantastic. Really happy. I think Shireen was happy with the entire lineup as well. Another minimal intervention producer we visited, he's fairly new in the village of Nitra. So it's a little bit north of South Slovakia. It's in the Nitriansky region. It was Marla Tindo. It was cool because the owner's names were Martin and Vlado. So if you could see the words today, Marla Tindo was kind of a play on their two names. I thought they were making phenomenal wines. Only making about 15,000 bottles a year from a couple of hectares of vineyards. The vines really reminded me of Movia in style. The Pinot Noir was, I thought, was fantastic. Minimal intervention Pinot Noir, also the Frankovka. And the Petnats were incredible. He made one out of Veltz Riesling, Riesling Vlaski. That was awesome. It wasn't finished. He opened it and it sprayed all over the place, which was really cool, but it still tastes delicious. It's a producer I will keep. We will definitely keep our eye on in the future. I think they're gonna just continue to produce better and better wines. They've only been on the market for so long. So that's it. I think Slovakia can make a name for itself making some of these minimal intervention wines. I found some of them to be exciting, even a couple of them to be great even. Not all of them were great, but there were definitely some really standout examples. I will put our tasting article in the description box so you can check some of that stuff out in better detail. So, guys, if you like this video, please subscribe to our YouTube channel, Exotic Wine Travel. I will see you in the next episode.